Is my mom here?
It's just us. You and us. Who you were in the park with?
I don't know names. I just got lost.
Where did you see the lady?
What lady?
The female jogger was severely beaten and raped.
Every black male who was in the park last night is a suspect. I need all of them.
What's going on with my son?
Your son was involved in rape in Central Park.
No, wait a second.
They saw you rape the lady.
I didn't see a lady or hit anyone.
I didn't see any lady.
Kevin.
I didn't see any lady.
I want to see my son right now, right now.
Whatever they said I did, I didn't.
I know. Zoning on the road. Nothing these boys state matches the central facts of the crime. All we need is for one to tie this whole thing together.
These tapes are not as clean as the state would have you believe.
There is injustice happening here.
There is not one shred of evidence.
Imagine the frenzy of these teenagers. Ripping off her
clothes. They are innocent of these crimes.
They are guilty.
They're doing us like this.
What other way they ever do us?
And I haven't looked back. I've been having these dreams.
I keep hearing these footsteps.
And they're coming closer and closer.
That's me coming to bring you home.
They said if I went along with it, that I could go home. And that's all I wanted.
The police will do anything. Lie on us, they will lock us up, they will kill us.
This is my life.
I don't think we should admit to something that we didn't do.
Okay, we keep fighting.
Friends, it's Loma here, otherwise known as Lomalicious, Lomita, or Momo. My grandson calls me Momo, and guess what? You can call me Momo too. I'm a proud grandma, but a sad one tonight because today is day 28 of my 28 movies of 28 days in Black History Month. And the movie that I'm reviewing tonight is When They See Us by Ava DuVernay. She's the creator of this as well. It's a four-part limited series on Netflix. And it's about the five gentlemen who were previously known as the Central Park Five, now the Exonerated Five. And it was so well done. I recommend this. Take a Sunday to just marathon it all, and you are going to feel such a range of emotions, so get your tissue boxes ready.
Of course I hate these people, and let's all hate these people, because maybe hate is what we need.
Well, I mean, I don't see anything insightful. I am strongly in favor of the death penalty. I'm also in favor of bringing back police forces that can do something instead of just turning their back, because every quality lawyer that represents people that are in trouble said the first thing they do is start shouting police brutality, etc. The disappointing aspect of it is that while 95% of the people agree with me, probably 40% of the columnists agree. I mean, I've had newspaper people, in fact, I had some woman the other day stick a microphone in my face from one of the major networks, but don't you have compassion for these young men that raped and beat and mugged and everything else this wonderful woman? something done. I mean, it's incredible when a reporter asks me whether or not I have compassion for the people that did this crime. I have absolutely no compassion.
Obviously.
I think they should be executed. I think you should have the death penalty. I think most people agree with me on that.
Was the ad careful to say if? Because there could have been a bystander. Well, there could have been someone wrongfully arrested. Anything.
I mean, here's a fairly long ad. It was fairly detailed and all, and you can take any interpretation.
April.
Mr. President, will you apologize to Central Park 5? They've been exonerated. There have been videos and movies shown about the case, and you came out with a full-page ad saying that they should die, that they should have the death penalty.
Why do you bring that question up now? It's an interesting time to bring it up. You have people on both sides of that. They admitted their guilt. If you look at Linda Fairstein and if you look at some of the prosecutors, they think that the city should never have settled that case. So we'll leave it at that.
Corey Wise, Raymond Santana Jr., Yusef Salam, Kevin Richardson, and Antron McRae would please come up and join us.
Raymond, what does it mean for you to have this film out in the world now?
Well, you know, first off, thank everybody for coming out. It's definitely a blessing to have you here with us. This film for us, and I'm gonna speak, you know, for everybody on this one, is, you know, back in 1989, we were 14, 15, and 16 years old, and during this process, our voices were stolen, and you guys who remember the headlines, you know the labels that we were given as a wolf pack, as urban terrorists, as rapists, and so this movie, when we saw it, it gave us back our voice. It gave you a chance to connect with us on a whole different level and for you to see us as what we really were, human beings. We were kids. And so this movie has become a great deal to us. It has been very therapeutic for us. It has given us a chance to connect with you guys. And the response that you give us is so overwhelming. It chokes us up. It chokes me every time I talk. The love is just so great, and whew, thank you.
Corey, I'd love to hear from you what this film means to you.
New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut, thank you for coming out. Thank y'all. God is great. I know it took my punch to put him down, to spark this up. I know I knocked out the blessing in disguise. I didn't know it was him. I was just doing my bit. But this here program. Thank you, Sarah. He's an angel. Dave, he's a soldier. The great Ken Burns, thank you. These are our guardian angels. Without this head, we ain't have no voice. We was innocent from the river, from kids. Then we went through hell, unneededly. Then it came down to a punch. Now it's heaven on earth. And I thank you. And I thank all of you. I'm glad we're still alive today.
I'll tell you a quick story. When I first met Sarah, we met at Starbucks. And I didn't know who she was. And she said, I want to sit down and talk to you about the case. And the first thing I thought is, who is this person? And then when we sat down and we talked for about 2 hours, speaking of everything, and I was like Corey said, this is an angel in disguise. And it was just overwhelming. It was a blessing for someone to really care about us and see our story. Because back in 1989, we didn't have a voice whatsoever. We was actually scared to speak because it was so negative. Because anything we say was spent on the negative side. So now that we're grown men, 38, 39, 40 years old, Corey, you know, we're grown men with kids, with families, and it feels so good. And it's so emotional. I get emotional every single time I see this. And I look over to see everybody. Everybody's crying. Everybody's angry, but in a good way. To get our story out, because everybody's so upset. So, once again, it's so overwhelming. And I thank y'all for coming. And we want to see y'all next week, the 23rd, 24th, 25th, in the future. And we want to get this story all over the world on the positive side.
First of all, I'd like to say thank you for coming out. The vibe is great. It's the reason why I escaped New York. I just had to get away, start a new life. Actually, I don't even go by Aaron Trump McCray no more. I just want to say thank you. The film is great. At first, I didn't trust Sarah or Dave. I haven't met Ken. It's the first time I met him in person. But I decided to give him a chance. Like Ray said in the film, I lost my religion. I don't believe in anything but myself. But I think tonight, I think that might change. Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, Dave. Thank you, Ken. I'm still kind of shy. I be 39, but I'm still kind of shy. I just want to say thank you.
Yusuf?
I think that in light of this film, and in light of what's happening to people's hearts in New York, I mean, we have supporters out there that were out, that were ready, that were willing and able to come. And many people didn't even know that we were exonerated. You know, I just looked at the film. I said, wow, I've been wearing a suit for a long time, you know. But this is my attire when I go to work, you know. And a lot of times people see me and they automatically think, oh, wow, you know, we're well off. We're doing our thing. And reality of the matter is that we're trying to put one foot in front of the other, you know. Somebody asked me once, will you ever get over this? And they were talking about something simple as, you know, me doing something like checking my door, making sure that the oven was off or something like that. You know, I said, I couldn't understand. You never get over something like this. This is like an indelible scar that you cannot surgically fix. And what's happening now is this case has been moving at such a slow, snail pace. The pace that it's taken, I mean, we're coming up on 10 years. It took 13 years for the truth to come out, which is for most folks would say is an unlucky number. You know, but 13 years later, the truth came out and we became exonerated and free and we could walk with our heads up as we were walking with our heads down inside. You know, and I have this little flyer that was made. It's actually on Facebook already. I published it on there. Not copywritten by me. My mom made it up. And she's actually with us in the audience. My mother and my grandmother. You know, talk about inspiration. I mean, my grandmother has had multiple strokes. And she would write me the most encouraging letters to get through my prison term. And my mom walking around with those Yusuf Salama's Innocence shirts, I tell you, man, that's awesome. You know, But our next court date is on the 17th of December. And what's been happening, which has been overwhelmingly pleasant, is that the courtroom is being packed and filled with supporters. And those supporters are kind of making, I think the first time it happened, the judge kind of came out and looked around and said, what's going on here? Is this something I missed? You know? And it's causing, because of the people's response, it's causing the judge to try to speed up this case. There was a speedy trial to convict us. There needs to be a speedy means to repair the damage that was done, you know? And I mean, I'm gonna tell you, like Corey said, there's no amount of money that can take that and repair it. You know, had this been the 1920s, the earlier part of the century, we would have all been hanging from trees in Central Park. That'd have been our reality, you know? Serious.
So basically, this one I'm just going to say right away, 10 out of 10, 20 out of 10. This is amazing. And the actors that portray them. So Yusuf Salam, I'll just read off my shirt. I just want to make sure you can see my shirt. Yusuf Salam is, he's a survivor, and he actually is a great, great public speaker now, and he wrote a book. Also, so Yusuf Salam, the younger version was played by Kevin Harris, and the older version was played by Chris Chalk. Kevin Richardson, the younger version was played by Asante Black, and the older version was played by Justin Cunningham. And then we have Antron McRae. Oh, Antron. I feel like Antron was so, so deeply affected by what had happened to them as children. The younger Antron is played by Khalil Harris. And the older Antron McRae is played by Jovan Adepo. And then we have, I'm going to go to Raymond Santana. Raymond Santana really, really struggled when he was released from jail. You know, it's hard to find work when you are convicted, and these, you know, oh, imagine your life is just ruined because you're convicted of a crime and you lose out on all that experience of working, schooling, and living your life. But imagine that you come out and you can't get a job due to your criminal record. And the young Raymond was played by Marquis Rodriguez, and the older Raymond Santana was played by Freddie Mieres, or Mary Myers. I'm not too sure how to pronounce that, hopefully. So basically, I'm going for gold at the end, and that is Corey Wise, to me, who suffered the worst, because he was not even on the list the police were looking for. He just accompanied his friend to the police station and ended up having the worst charges and being sent to Rikers Island as a teenager with real criminals, men, and violent gang. You know, it just, I just could not imagine, and everything that he had to go through. He also had, he was hearing impaired as well, and they took advantage of that. So the actor who plays Corey Wise in this is Jarrell Jerome, and he actually won an Emmy, a Golden Globe, for his performance, because it is just absolutely phenomenal.
Here are this year's nominees. Jared Harris, Chernobyl.
When the truth offends, we lie and lie until we can no longer remember it is even there, but it is still there.
Sam Rockwell, Fosse Verdon.
Anything I want to do, the only thing I want to do is be with you.
Benicio Del Toro, Escape at Dannemora.
Final road. Stop a car. We'll be in Canada in 45 minutes.
You just want to kill some people, leave some bodies in the middle of the road?
What'd you pick up that gun for?
Jarrell Jerome, When They See Us.
They was yelling at me. They was screaming at me and hitting on me. So I figured I tell them what they wanted. If I tell them what they wanted, I could go home. So that's what I did.
Mahershala Ali, True Detective.
Listen to me, I'm a cop, state police. Lock down the store now. I'll make an announcement. Give me the mic.
Oh, sir, I don't think that you...
Give me the mic!
Hugh Grant, A Very English Scandal.
I don't care if we shoot him, or we strangle him, or we poison him, or we bludgeon him, or we tie him up in a sack and drop him in the Thames. There is only one way for us to survive. Norman Scott has got to die, so how?
And the Emmy goes to... Jarrell Jerome.
First nomination and win for Jarrell Jerome, a graduate of LaGuardia High School for the Performing Arts. The place where if you want fame, you literally pay for classes in sweat. Bottles of sweat.
I feel like I should just be in the Bronx right now, chilling, waiting for my mom's cooking or something. But I'm here in front of my inspirations. I'm here in front of people who I'm so motivated by. And the reason I'm here is because of actors like the people I was in the category with. I have to thank my mom, who's with me today, my beautiful mother. I couldn't do it without her. My dad, Sierra, Titi, Mali, Tariq, Mama, Papa, te quiero. Of course, Ava, thank you for giving me this opportunity. Netflix, my team, Perry, Emily, Jen, UTA, everybody. Jordan, I know you out there. But most importantly, this is for the men that we know as the Exonerated Five. It's for Raymond, Yusuf, Antron, Kevin, and King Corey Wise. Thank you so much. It's an honor, it's a blessing.
This movie, this limited series is absolutely, absolutely 20 out of 10. I'm giving it 20 out of 10 momos. I think a lot of what I've been talking about over all this Black history is all the young Black men, women, and children that have lost their lives to police officers, and not just police officers. Sometimes it's just your everyday citizen, and they actually get away with murder. I just don't understand how people can get away with killing someone who is unarmed, and they're the ones with the weapons getting completely off scot-free. So some of the other actors in this did phenomenal. We know we have our issues with Felicity Huffman, but she really plays that Linda Fairstein amazingly. And Vera Farmiga plays the prosecutor, she does so amazingly well. You can see sometimes how they're torn about certain things, like they know that they're setting up these boys, but what can they do? They're just going to continue to do what they're supposed to do, get these guys behind bars, because they know that people don't really care. They just want to see somebody paying for the crime. And then once they found out who the real perpetrator was, the boys, Corey Wise was the last one in prison at the time, and he finally was able to be set free. So it is a compelling story. I just highly recommend this movie. I just am really tired of seeing young men, women, and children being killed, especially the children. It just angers me when I hear of children being killed and harmed, and we gotta work and do better. So I'm so happy that you were able to join me on this journey. I am definitely gonna talk about the story more. This, I'm very passionate about the story. Just happy to know that they're free and that they got the justice in the end, although justice is still not here for a lot of people of color, racialized people. They're still suffering due to the, at the hands of people, racism, and a system that is racist. It's systematic racism. 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 There's so many stories to tell, and the reason we need to tell these stories, and the reason you need to see a lot of the things in the past, like Levittsville. I can't wait to share that story about that community.
In August 1957, Levittown, Pennsylvania, attracted international attention when violence erupted as William Myers Jr. and his family moved into the three-bedroom house at Daffodil and Deep Green Lanes. In almost all respects, the Myers family is close to the Levittown norm. They have three small children, the youngest only 1 month old. Myers served for 2.5 years in the Army and was discharged as a staff sergeant. He works as a laboratory technician and is studying for a degree as an electrical engineer. His wife, Daisy, is a college graduate. The Myers home is modestly furnished, and their late model family car was bought on time. They are very close to the Levittown norm, except in one respect. William Myers Jr. and his family are Negroes in an all-white community.
I was terribly shocked to find that there were people in this community who would be so violently opposed to it. I rather thought that everyone would just accept it as I would.
That in the end, it probably will end up with mixing socially. And you will have, well, I think their aim is mixed marriages and becoming equal with the whites. I'll do what I can to help to get them out legally and peacefully. And as far as accepting them socially, if that's what you mean, I could never do that.
Some of the people are definitely against integration. And they have told my children that they have to marry. And my child doesn't even know what a nigger is, but from the sound, it has scared them, and they have come home just crying. Mommy, do I have to marry niggers? And my answer in handling all the fears that children come in is that you can marry whomever you wish. Where there were several colored people. And I can honestly say one of my best friends was a colored girl. And as children have no prejudice, we became very close friends. I have found several colored people that I have enjoyed their friendship.
Has this affected your relationship with neighbors?
No, we've discussed it freely. We found people for and against, but we've tried to keep it being discussed. That was the important thing. I won't repeat them because I don't like to repeat rumors, and I don't think it's fair to keep them alive. We had some very interested citizens here who pledged themselves to a fact-finding group, and they tried to dissolve those rumors as quickly as they were started by facts. I think the majority of people here will grow accustomed to it and realize that they can be good neighbors, which I'm sure they are. And I think the majority of people here are not the violent, violent group that we have heard so much about. I don't think that the Myers have anything to do with the property decreasing or increasing. I think it's purely a white problem, not a Negro problem. people who want these homes will come here. I hope, and because I would like to see an integrated group here, and I would like to see, well, my child, and I hope my children go to and live in a group that is representative of the world. And not being an integrated group, it is not now a representative of society. Of course, we've all discussed this, and we've all said that the answer to the problem is eventually when you find that there are no more areas to which a white person can move without having a Negro family in. Well, that would be the best end that there could be to segregation, and it is probably something that will happen in the future, perhaps in the near future.
Because people still have these attitudes today. It is insane how a lot of the mindset is still the same, and we really, really, really want to change things for our children. It's really trying to keep and uphold white supremacy, and we really need to end it because it has not made a better world. It has made this world a terrible place, and we really need to change that and change things for the future. So thank you so much. That was my Black History 28 Movies in 28 Days, but I do have my honorable mentions, and I am going to be reviewing those too.
God, please, no! 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 No!
I just will not be reviewing. Every day, I'm going to say one movie a week, or a couple movies a month, and I'm gonna go with that. And I still wanna talk to people and interview and conversate and learn. I am all about learning. I'm all about fighting. And thank you so much. I hope you enjoyed this as much as I did. And hey, I'm still gonna be doing this, just not as much, because I lost a lot of sleep. Anyway, I had fun, and stick around because there's more to come. Okay, my friends, have a great night, and I hope you enjoyed this. Let's keep fighting for justice, and, you know, because things, even though we've taken baby steps, that's all it's been, baby steps, and we really need to do more. So thank you again. So have a great night, and peace be with you. Great night, my friends, and we will see you soon.